Okay, so we are going to start by looking at a perfect score. So you can see in the first question, this person did exactly what I hoped they would to help them out for the rest of the assessment. They have their trig values over here, and then they have where each of the three trig functions are positive and negative. And then they just wrote O squared plus A squared equals H squared to represent a general right triangle, and they started by dividing by O to get 1 plus cotangent squared equals cosecant squared. They then divided by A and got tangent squared plus 1 equals secant squared, and then divided by H and got sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1. And that's why I didn't want you to memorize those, because they're really not too hard to derive once you know how to do it. So then notice on question 2 that they started by trying to deal with the right side of the equation over here and realized that was going to be harder than dealing with the left side. So then they crossed that out and jumped over here and said tangent is secant squared minus 1. Sine squared is 1 minus cosine squared. They foiled that, which can be kind of tough, but you just have to keep all your signs straight. So they got secant squared plus cosine squared minus cosine squared secant squared minus 1, recognizing that cosine squared and secant squared are reciprocals, so that's 1. And then they did some rearranging, so they said we have secant squared minus 1. They put that there, and then they said cosine squared minus 1. Because they knew that secant squared minus 1 is tangent squared, and that cosine squared minus 1 is sine squared. So now they've effectively showed that tangent squared times sine squared equals tangent squared minus sine squared. And a lot of people who got that one did it in several different ways. There's like a 2-step way, you could probably do it in like a 10-step way, but the important thing is that you get to the final result. So then they recognized the slope of the hypotenuse multiplied by the length of the opposite side is the same as the opposite side subtracted from the slope. And then I put this comment here that I didn't end up taking points off for anybody, but I said they're all squared though. Remember, we have tangent squared and sine squared. And further, tangent squared is always slope, but sine squared isn't always just the opposite side. It's ratio of opposite to hypotenuse. And only in the unit circle when the hypotenuse is 1 does the sine just represent the opposite side. Okay, they did a great job on their angle conversions. Won't spend too much time looking at those. The big thing that people ran into was that they wrote 5 pi over 6 instead of 17 pi over 6. Remember, those are different angles. They represent a different number of times around the unit circle. So 5/10 is a full time at least around the unit circle. So we should have at least 12 pi over 6, and then we add the 5 pi over 6 is the 150. These two are pretty straightforward. Same thing here. 12 pi over 3 is 720, and then you add the pi over 3, which is 60. So she did a great job there. Cotangent squared times tangent squared is reciprocal. So right away, recognize that was 1. Then we have tangent squared times cosine squared over cotangent squared times sine squared. And then recognize that cosine squared over sine squared is cotangent. So they canceled the cotangents and just had 1 plus tangent squared, which gave the correct answer of secant squared. All right, jumping now to the back side. And number 5 was kind of tough for a lot of people. First thing you have to be able to do is isolate cosine squared and recognize that 6 over 8 should be written as 3 over 4. And the only reason that we need to know that is because then when we take a square root, we get square root 3 over square root 4, which is square root 3 over 2. They remembered to do plus or minus, which a lot of people forgot. So because it's plus or minus, reference angle for cosine and root 3 over 2 is pi over 6. So then it's pi over 6, 5 pi over 6, 7 pi over 6, and 11 pi over 6. And then the restrictions a lot of people got confused about too. So they did a great job of showing, okay, if cosine theta is greater than 0, that eliminates it down to pi over 6 and 11 pi over 6. And then if tangent theta is greater than 0, that eliminates 11 pi over 6 because tangent's not positive in the fourth quadrant, and now that is the only answer. Okay, part B, the main thing that people missed if they got a lot of points on this was that they canceled cosines, so you added this over to the other side and canceled cosines. We're going to talk about how that eliminates some answers, but what you should do is factor out a cosine first. And then, so they started kind of going down this path of calling cosine, cosecant, cotangent, but what you should do instead is recognize that you have a common factor of cosine. So you factor out cosine, you get cosine times cosecant minus 2 root 3, and now you have two factors that you can set equal to 0. So cosine theta equals 0, you get pi over 2, 3 pi over 2. Cosecant theta equals 2 root 3 gives sine theta root 3 over 2. And then there's the two answers for sine theta equals root 3 over 2, so 4 answers total. Down here, a lot of people tried to foil these, but they're already factored for you. And when you have factors, you can just set each factor equal to 0. So we get sine theta equals 1/2, sine theta equals negative root 3 over 2. There's the 4 answers for that. Did a great job on the derivative, showing a unit circle, and then recognizing that cosine theta is going to switch directions. It's going to switch from increasing to decreasing whenever cosine theta is equal to negative 1/2. Because that's when the derivative is zero, right? And if you picture a derivative of zero, that's either a max or a min, right? So if you have a max or a min, then that means that you're switching from increasing to decreasing or decreasing to increasing. So at 2 pi over 3, we have a zero of the derivative, and also at 4 pi over 3. And then it's just a matter of recognizing that, well, at the start, cosine is positive, so the derivative will be positive at the start. It's going to switch at 2 pi over 3 to become negative. So that means from 2 pi over 3 to 4 pi over 3, it's decreasing, increasing everywhere else. This one was very tricky. You had to recognize that sine and cosecant are only equal when they're both equal to 1, since cosecant's the reciprocal. And then the main thing here, and they got the correct intervals, but the main thing here was to recognize that if you have, on the positive side, when sine's positive, let's say you have 1/2 minus 1 over 1/2, that's going to give you 1/2 minus 2, which is negative 1/2. And again, that's only going to switch direction. It's only going to switch when the derivative is 0. So the derivative is 0 at pi over 2 and 3 pi over 2, right? Well, what happens, though, is at pi over 2, we actually have a bounce situation where the derivative goes negative again, because, again, sine's positive, so we're going to get the same result we got here. When sine's positive, we're going to be subtracting the bigger reciprocal, which is going to make a negative. But in the bottom two quadrants, down here, where sine's negative, we have negative 1/2, for example, minus negative 1 over 1/2, which is going to be negative 1/2 plus 2, which is positive. So then it turns out that it's increasing the whole time down here, except for at 3 pi over 2, where it's 0. So that's why they said pi to 3 pi over 2 and 3 pi over 2 to 2 pi. And I'm not going to focus on this graph one because a lot of people got that one pretty well, and we're running out of time.